the Council of Nicaea. Before this occurred, there were several different competing views of Christ. Then the Emperor Constantine assembled them all together to decide on one view of Christ. They met for days, fighting and bickering, until finally the current view of Christianity won, and the divinity of Christ was declared. Then the new Orthodox view used its power to stomp out and erase all other competing views of Christianity. Or so we're told. You know, I hear this story a lot from atheists, cults, Muslims, and several other non-Christian groups. They always give me this generic story to try to show me that the Council of Nicaea made up the divinity of Jesus and created a new version of Christianity. However, this is all I ever hear, this generic story. I never get any more details from skeptics, and there's a good reason why. Because when we study the details of what happened before, during, and after the council met, this fable is easily debunked, and we see that Christ's divinity was not made up at the council. So let's start with events that led up to the council. On February 24th, in 303 AD, the worst persecution of Christians began under the Emperor Diocletian and lasted until Emperor Galerius finally issued a general edict of tolerance in 311 AD. 2 years later, in 313 AD, with the Edict of Milan, the Emperor Constantine finally legalized Christianity and allowed its practice. Now I want to stop here and make sure this point is clear. Constantine did not make Christianity the official religion of the empire. He simply commanded official tolerance of Christianity. He did, however, outlaw Jews from stoning Christians and gladiator shows, although they did persist until the 5th century. It wasn't until 380 AD, under the Emperor Theodosius, that Christianity was left as the only legal religion. Shortly after Christianity was made legal, a pastor from Alexandria named Arius began preaching the idea that Jesus was not God, but a created being. He gained a following and began disputing with Alexander, the Bishop of Alexandria. So in 321 AD, a local council declared Arius a heretic. However, Arius just moved to Palestine, where he gained a larger following, and over the course of the next few years, the debate became so intense that it gained the attention of Emperor Constantine. Constantine, who had just unified the empire, didn't want anything that would threaten division. He saw the debate between the Christians and Arians as a threat to the stability of the empire, so he moved to settle it. He officially called the council in 325 AD. There were no Gnostics involved, there were no Ebionites involved, or any other groups. The council was called to settle disputes between Christians and Arians only. Most other heretical views of Christianity, like Gnosticism, had mostly died out by this point, and the majority of those professing to be Christians were Orthodox Christians, so there was not a wide variety of different views at the council. Although Constantine originally invited over 1,800 bishops from across the empire, only around 300 were able to attend. Most of them were from the east, with only about a dozen representing the west. Now, it should be remembered what happened to these men less than two decades ago. Most of them suffered through one of the greatest Christian persecutions of all time. Many of them faced brutal torture and imprisonment for their faith. So despite the modern view about the participants at the council, they were not the type of men who were fine with compromising their beliefs, especially if a few years earlier they were willing to die for them. These bishops actually assembled in Nicaea to confirm what they had already believed and deal with Arius' teachings. Now there were three parties at the council. The smallest was Arius and a handful of bishops that agreed with him, that the Father and Jesus were of different substance, or heterousios. The second and much larger group was the Orthodox group, led by Hoseas of Cordova and Alexander of Alexandria. Also in this group was the young deacon Athanasius. This group held the long-standing belief of the church that Jesus was fully God and had existed eternally with the Father. They said Jesus was of the same substance, or homoousios. Then there was a third group, roughly equal in size to the Orthodox group, called the Eusebian group, led by Eusebius of Caesarea. However, this group didn't differ on theology from the Orthodox view. They also believed Jesus was fully God and had existed eternally with the Father. They only differed on the use of the word homoousios. The reason is because in previous centuries, modalist heresies had used the word to teach that the Father and Jesus were one person and not coexisting persons of one being. So in actuality, the Orthodox group and the Eusebian group didn't differ on theology or the deity of Christ. They only differed on terminology. Now, a big modern myth is that Emperor Constantine forced Trinitarian views on the church, but this simply is not historically supported. Although he presided over the council, he did not push any particular view. He was no theologian. All he wanted was that both sides would come to an agreement and there would be unity in the church. The Orthodox group listened to the views of Arius, and they overwhelmingly rejected his views as being new and distant from the view of the church. Eusebius writes that some of the bishops tore up letters containing Arius' teachings. He then writes that church leaders interrogated Arius using scripture, but found he had a new way of interpreting every piece of scripture. They then pointed out that his views had to be wrong because it was new and it wasn't taught in any early church history. Athanasius rhetorically asked, "How many fathers can you cite for your phrases?" They then formed the Nicene Creed, which is a clear condemnation of Arius' teachings and a confirmation of the Orthodox view. In the end, all but Arius and two bishops signed the creed, clearly showing there was no major divisions in church theology. The council then moved to deal with other issues, such as which day to formally celebrate Easter. They formally denounced Gnosticism and other minor sects, publicized 20 canon laws, and dealt with other minor issues. The council did not decide on the biblical canon. The canon had evolved on its own over time. However, according to the Muratorian fragment, the canon was nearly complete by the end of the 2nd century. The council did not decide on the use of the word Trinity. It dealt primarily with the divinity of Christ. The word Trinity can be found in early Christian history as it was used by early church fathers. An acceptance of a divine three can also be found in other early Christian writings. Now, the results of the council did not actually please Constantine. In fact, he was very angry at the Christians. He wanted unity and compromise, not for one side to denounce the other. He actually took pity on the Arians. Arius was exiled and fled to Illyria for a short time, while his heresy began to spread and gain political power, especially when on her deathbed, Constantine's sister urged Constantine to support Arius, and he actually did. Arius found a new crafty way of interpreting the Nicene Creed in his favor, and Constantine invited him back so he could force the church to readmit him. However, Arius died before this could happen. A follower of Arius, Eusebius of Nicomedia, was able to sway Constantine more in favor of the Arian view. Just before his death, Eusebius of Nicomedia baptized Constantine, effectively symbolizing his siding with the Arians. After Constantine's death, the Arians continued to gain more ground against the Orthodox view. The Arian bishops that Constantine had favored used their political power to fight against Christianity. Constantine was succeeded by two Arian emperors in the east who worked with Arian bishops in an attempt to override Nicaea and write a new creed. Although Arians were still in the minority, they were given much more political power, which they used to try to stamp out Christianity. Many Christian leaders were forced into subscribing to creeds that did not favor either side. Jerome later described this time period as when the whole world groaned and was astonished to find itself Arian. However, despite the power of the Arians, one bishop fought back almost completely by himself. Athanasius of Alexandria continued to argue from scripture and stand against the might of the Arian heresy. Even when he was banished and removed from his position 5 times, he never swayed and stood for truth against the Arian political machine. He was a popular hero who prevented Christian theology from compromising and giving in to the Arians. So the Arians turned to gaining more political power. But just before the Arians completely consolidated their hold over the empire, they turned to internal fighting and destroyed themselves. It wasn't long before all their political power was lost, and the Christians were able to meet in 381 AD at the Council of Constantinople and reaffirm the Nicene faith. The battle between the Arians and the Christians did not end there. After the Council of Nicaea, many Arian bishops headed north and began converting the Germanic tribes to Arianism. They then eventually conquered the Western Roman Empire, and the Christians had to deal with Arianism again. However, as we can see today, Arianism died out, and Christianity is still going strong and growing. So as you can see, Christian bishops did not inherit absolute political power from the Council of Nicaea and use it to stomp out other competing sects. On the contrary, it was the Arians who gained the political power and tried to stomp out the true church. So there is no evidence the council created Christianity, the concept of the Trinity, or the divinity of Jesus, or used political power to erase other competing sects. This myth about the council is a complete fairy tale. It astonishes me how many non-Christians used the Council of Nicaea to try to claim Christianity was made up in 325 AD, when historically there is just no evidence for it.